now.
Yep, I bet that.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Welcome to what I hope is going to be our final Oasis service on Zoom. And as Linda helpfully reminded me in an email, potentially our last service online, kind of fully online. Ever, maybe. So it feels like a significant one, this. So thank you for joining us. As ever, we'll stick to our usual running time of 45 minutes and we'll stay on for half an hour afterwards so we can all catch up properly as well. So that'll be nice. Before I carry on, I'm going to pray. So shall we pray? We thank you, Lord Jesus, for this time together. And we welcome you here among us. We thank you that through this really long season of being physically apart, you have kept us spiritually close and you have never left us. And we thank you that you are as much with us this morning as you have been throughout this past year. So please enter our lives, fill our homes. You are welcome here by your Holy Spirit to meet with us, to bring us truth this morning, to teach us more about you, to cast out our fears and anxieties, and to lead us into a deeper, more loving relationship with you. That is what we want today, Lord Jesus. So come and do that amongst us, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay.
I'm not finished just yet, Linda.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, I'm still going. Just a second and then you can have it. I hope you all had a chance to receive at least the sheet that I emailed around earlier in the week and that I posted on Slack. If you have, you'll know that our theme for this month is freedom in Christ. I'm not sure why Linda and I fell on this, but it seemed to be appropriate for just a time when we're talking a lot about being free and particularly coming out of lockdown. But we're not talking about our physical freedom, rather something a bit deeper than that. So, you know, freedom in Christ is something that Christians and the church talk a lot about. But what does it actually mean? How are the Easter story and freedom connected? That's what we're going to be exploring. But first, before anything else, Linda is going to start off some worship for us. I'm going to put us all on mute as well. In just a moment. And if you don't have the sheet that I emailed around, I'm going to put it in the chat while we're worshipping.
Okay. So as Lauren said, we're still in the season of
Oh, sorry, I've muted you, Linda.
Brilliant. Just to say as well, my internet seems to be really unstable this morning. So if things freeze, it's probably my fault. But our first song that we're going to sing this morning, considering we're still in the season of Easter, this song reminds us about what the cross actually means, what it means for each one of us, that Christ has overcome, the chains are breaking, and his love is setting us free.
Is shining, so people open your eyes. The cross stands above it all, burning bright in this life. The cross towers over it all. One hope, one deliverer, Savior reigning high above it all. Above it all.
You can't beat the smell of fresh fish cooking on the beach. Breakfast is the best time to have fish, I reckon. Just smell that. Oh. Catching fish at breakfast time is the best time as well. We'd spent many an early morning and night out there fishing. Before we met Jesus, that is. I remember the last time we went fishing. Actually, it was here on this very spot that we had breakfast with our Lord. We'd been out there all night and not caught a single fish, not even a little bite. We were so cold and hungry. I suppose it was my idea to go fishing. It seemed the natural thing to go back to after, well, all that we'd been through. It'd been a long week. We thought we would be with Jesus forever. We couldn't quite believe what had happened to him. So the best thing this day, we thought, was to go fishing. But the sun was up, and I says to the lads, "This is no good. Let's turn the boat round. We'll get back to shore. Cold and I'm hungry." But as we do, there was this bloke standing on the shore, just watching us.
"Have you caught anything?"
"Is he taking the mick?"
"Try putting your nets on the other side of the boat."
Couldn't believe he was telling me how to fish. But before I could say smoke mackerel, all the others were chucking a net on the other side of the boat, just as he had asked them. I called out to him, "Are you happy now?"
"Happy now."
Now, I thought I'd seen Jesus' last miracle when he healed that soldier's ear. You know, the one I'd cut off.
Yeah.
Well, this. We were just sitting in a boat waiting to see what would happen, when wham! Suddenly, the nets were filled with fish.
"Look at all these fish! Look at all the fish! We got fish!"
I'd never seen so many fish before. We were struggling to pull them in. The boat was bending over. It was amazing. And then one of the lads turns round to me and says, "Peter! Peter! It's the Lord! It's Jesus." Well, I didn't wait. Fully clothed, I dived straight out of the boat into the water. It was him. It was him. It was really him. Alive and cooking fish. We brought him plenty more.
and we all just sat with our Lord. None of us really knew what to say. But he was back. We didn't know for how long, but it didn't matter. Then he takes me to one side and says to me three times, "Peter, do you love me?" Three times I said, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Then I realized what he was doing. Remember, three times I denied him. And now Jesus, well, this was his way of forgiving me, giving me a fresh start. Because now, he's got a very special job for me. So we sat and we had breakfast on the beach with the risen Lord.
Thanks, Linda. Did anyone else notice just at that end bit that when the music started, it was a part of the theme from Pirates of the Caribbean? Was that just me? I'm fairly sure that was plagiarised. Never mind. As I said at the start, I hope you've had a chance to look through the sheet of questions that I gave you. We're going to go into our breakout rooms now. If you don't have the sheet in front of you, it's available in the chat. You should have that, everyone, for you. So there are two big questions for our breakout rooms. The first one is all about exploring the passage together. And it's worth saying that there are no wrong answers as you explore these together. So just talk about what things come to your mind, what you feel, how you interpret the passage, and share that with each other and see how we all engage with it differently. So those questions are about what your favourite part of that story is and why. And if you want to find the whole thing, it's in John chapter 21. Are there any moments throughout that story that remind you of other parts of Jesus's life and ministry? And there was a reference to that in the video too. Particularly, how do we think Peter felt before this encounter with Jesus and afterwards, and thinking the whole time about what freedom might mean in Jesus? And then if you'd like to, this might just be one for yourself to think about personally, and it might be one for you to share with the group if you'd like to, about what freedom in Christ means to you personally, how you understand it, or even how you experience it in your own life. So some big questions, but I hope for some really fruitful discussions. So I'm going to create some breakout rooms. It'll be five per room. That's a good idea. Create that. And we'll have 10 minutes together in these rooms. So you'll get an invite now.
Oh, there's Tony.
Oh, there's Tony on now. Good. Ah,
good. Good. Lawrence.
Lawrence. Oh, dear. Yes.
Yes, I always enter the group that I think is going to be the most trouble.
I thought that might be the case. Yeah.
Well, I just had to confess, Lawrence, that, well, neither did you. We didn't pick up your email, but we've got it now. Through your chat.
I'm personally offended, Margaret.
Oh, sorry. No. You were in Devon.
I was down in Devon yesterday.
Yeah. No internet in Devon.
No. Yeah, well, the dark lands down there, aren't they? Yes, I don't think they've even got electricity yet, have they? So
what's the first question?
This always happens with the group I enter as well. They went, "Oh, good, you're here, Lawrence. You can tell us what we're supposed to be doing."
Your favourite part.
I don't think someone had it. I'm on my phone, so I can't have the paper open at the same time.
I've got a second screen here. So we can answer any or all of them. Favourite parts of the story? Any moments that remind you of other parts of Jesus's life and ministry? Engaging with how Peter felt throughout this narrative.
Well, you must have recalled the story in Luke chapter 5 of the miraculous draught, which involved Peter as well, in Jesus' human life before the crucifixion. and almost a way of saying it's the same person.
I like particularly the conversation when Jesus says, have you caught anything? And, why don't you try the other side of the boat? And they did it quite well in the video, I thought. Sometimes scripture, yes, I think, edits out all of the sort of likely conversation that took place. But I always thought it would be a few expletives probably going on in the boat there about that.
Yeah,
wasn't it Peter that got out of the boat in the storm?
Yes.
Yeah. So he's done it again, hasn't he?
This time. One of the things that I love about the whole passage here is that there's so many echoes, and I wanted to try and frame a question around that, because I think there's so much here that John is trying to say. He's saying, look, this is definitely Jesus, and if you didn't believe that, look, it's definitely Jesus. And if you've missed those two, it's still definitely Jesus. I think it's really wonderful. I mean, the one that jumps out to me is the appearing to them with the breaking of the bread as well. So you've got the road to Emmaus being reflected in that sharing of breakfast as well. And any bit of the gospel that mentions food, I'm always a fan of.
Feeding the 5,000 bread and fish.
Yeah. And he took it and gave it to them. You can just imagine they would have been speechless and trying to work out what was happening, but feeding the 5,000 came to mind on that.
Yeah, good spot, Chris. I'd miss that one.
You say that twice in time to count the fish.
I think of when he originally called the early disciples as well, when they were fishing, I think again, same, it's reflecting this idea of same person.
Yeah. Because the last verse in the reading, I think, is follow me, isn't it? Jesus says, Peter, follow me. A reiteration of what he said right at the start, really.
Yeah. Again, I'd miss that one as well. So.
It's there, don't there?
It's incredible. So that question of feelings and emotions, often we're not particularly good, I think, at engaging with how the characters in the story might feel, and this is a huge part of Ignatian prayer, and even godly play. I mean, it's something that happens at both ends of the spectrum of, you know, people beginning their walk with Jesus and those who kind of at the I can never say that word, the meditative stage, should we say, kind of experience meditation in the passages. Any thoughts on Peter's feelings throughout this?
I imagine when Jesus is saying, do you love me? And he's saying, of course I do. Probably at the time he wasn't realising what was going on, and afterwards, maybe when he was thinking about it all, that sense of liberation might have come, because I think at the time he would have been so sort of indignant of course I do, you know, why do you keep asking?
Yeah, it says Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him a third time. Makes you wonder, how did Jesus
He must have... Must have recalled his denial three times, and why could anybody trust Peter after that?
I'm intrigued by the bit where none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord.
Yeah,
and it's kind of, I don't know, I struggle with this Jesus. They could recognise him, but they couldn't recognise him, kind of risen body, unrisen body. I just really don't really get what's going on, whether it be on the road to Emmaus or kind of here, because it almost sounds like there was some doubt, but yet they knew, if you know what I mean. I don't know what other people think.
But they'd seen he was dead. So, seeing him alive would make you think, well, is it really you? We see it's you, but is it really we saw you dead.
Yeah, I guess
that's it. This is the third time that Jesus has appeared to his disciples. Yeah, and I think you're right, Jeremy. There is this ambiguity about Jesus' appearance that, you know, obviously it's Jesus, he's still got the wounds, but there's something transformed about him. You know, you read commentary after commentary on the resurrection, and the thing that they'll all hammer home is that, you know, this is not revival, it's resurrection, and they're very different. You know, Jesus is not just, you know, his body has not been brought back to life, he has been, this is something completely, it's a complete renewal. And there's a really important distinction that I'm sure is far deeper than I've been able to express there. You know, Jesus is not just alive again, but he is alive again. This is like the fullness of life lived out amongst them. So it's probably alien. I think there's something about Jesus's being here that is something that they've never seen before, because this is a resurrection body, something that we can all look forward to. And it will be distinct from what we know now. Maybe it's just that kind of sense of difference that they recognize must be Jesus, because he's the only one.
Also, I guess in John, the other two times were in the locked room, right? Before Thomas and with Thomas. And so maybe the expectation level was just so low they didn't imagine Jesus, you know, appearing outdoors or on a beach at a distance. It was, I don't know, it just makes me think.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Amazes me that Jesus could actually eat. He did eat with them, I imagine. But, you know, in his new body,
resurrected body,
yeah, that he could eat.
Is it, yeah, in one of the Gospels, it's not John, the first thing he says is, I'm hungry. Give me something to eat. Which again, I love. I love anything to do with food. Yeah, but exactly what you said, Margaret. There's that kind of intentional pointing out that this is a real kind of flesh and blood person. You know, it's not a ghost. It's someone who's hungry. Amazing. I hope other groups have had as interesting conversation as we have. 10 minutes just flies by. For me.
Doesn't it?
I will close the rooms now, and I shall see you in a moment.
Okay.
I hope everyone had as fruitful discussions as we had in our group. Set aside a few minutes here for any feedback, anything that anyone wants to share from what they were discussing, anything that's jumped out at them from this passage, anything that's spoken to them this morning, anything freedom related. Just bear in mind that you're all muted, but if you'd like to share something, unmute yourself and go ahead. As ever, if there's nothing, that's absolutely fine.
Yeah. No, I was thinking, Lawrence, it all comes back to me when we went to Israel with Roberts, and I remember standing on the beach by the Sea of Galilee thinking, yeah, this is where Jesus, and it's something that's never left me.
Amazing. So yeah, to actually walk in his footsteps.
It's
an incredible thing. I imagine the number of people here have done that. A few nods. Incredible. Thanks, George. Is there anything else, or shall I share a few words? Right. In which case, I hope that one of the things that has come out of this is that freedom will have meant different things to all the disciples that met with Jesus at this point. And it, well, I think it also will probably mean freedom in Jesus, this idea will mean something different to all of us, because we've all got our own individual walks with Jesus. Although we're one body, we all have our own faiths, our own journeys, and our own experiences of freedom. So I think there's lots of things that freedom is, but I think there's also a couple of things that freedom definitely isn't, that unites all of us. I think for Christians, freedom is not the ability for us to indulge every whim or desire that we might have. And it's also not freedom from consequences for our actions. Of course, I mean, people are free to believe that they are free to do those things. But I think we all know that deep down, true freedom can't mean a completely permissive lifestyle, because our actions always have consequences. And we know that it's not good for us to indulge our every whim, because it's not good for us physically or mentally or spiritually. And that kind of fake freedom can lead us, and I think we see around the world, has led the world to believe that they actually don't need God, and they don't need his provision or his love. True freedom must mean something deeper than simply who we are or what we do, if that makes sense. So thinking about the passage that we've just explored together for a moment, what does freedom in Jesus mean for Peter right here? I don't know about you, I feel like Peter feels trapped. I think he's trapped by guilt for the way that he betrayed Jesus. And now he feels a physical and spiritual distance between themselves. Peter has already met the risen Lord Jesus twice at this point. But rather than celebrating and finding a really kind of joyous character in Peter, instead, the very first thing we hear in the gospel that Peter says after the resurrection is, "I'm going out to fish." He's trapped in his old life, and he doesn't yet understand that Jesus's new life also means a new life for him. So I think that we discover true freedom for Peter when Jesus asks him to affirm their relationship. So as we heard in the video, three times he asks, "Do you love me?" And there's three opportunities for Peter to repent of that sin of rejection, to accept Jesus's forgiveness, and to reestablish their covenant of love together. Peter gives up fishing, as far as we're aware, from this point on, and he goes on to be the completely transformed man that we find in Acts. And I'll say at this point, we're going to be finishing our Acts series, part three, from next week when we reopen the church. So that's exciting, something to look forward to. So as I said, freedom in Christ means something different to each of us. Just to share something personal, for me, the freedom that comes at Easter is knowing that I don't have to save myself. This is a really short way of talking about something that's quite deep for me. It's so amazing for me to know that it is Jesus who died, Jesus who was punished in my place, and it is Jesus who rose again from the dead. And knowing that it is Jesus who did all this, it means that I can find comfort in my own powerlessness. I can kind of find peace in knowing that it's not about me. I'm not expected to save myself, because only Jesus could do this amazing work of salvation. And he offers the rewards of eternity and forgiveness to me for completely free, and to all of us. And for me, that's what freedom is. It's freedom from saving myself. And maybe that's something that echoes with you as well in your relationship with Jesus. I think true freedom is to be released from the things that trap each one of us, whether that's guilt or feelings of inadequacy, rejection or fear over things that we've done or have been done to us. It's able to live lives knowing that we are loved and free to love others. I think it's to have our relationships with Jesus, the saviour of the world, affirmed by him. We're going to come now to a time of prayer that Linda's going to lead us in. And perhaps as we do that, we can reflect on what freedom has meant in our lives in Jesus, and how today we can thank Jesus for setting us free. So Linda, over to you.
Pin me. I hope you all got the message to get a stone and have a stone ready. So if you've got it there, you need to put it on the table in front of you or put it on the floor beside you. If you haven't got one, if there's something near to hand that you can put in your hand, hold in your hand, that'd be great. And the other thing is, if you're not muted, could you mute yourselves now so that we don't interrupt each other in this prayer time. So let's pray. Today we've been thinking about freedom, freedom in Christ. We've explored the story of Peter and seen how his encounter with the risen Jesus on the beach brought forgiveness and freedom. Perhaps our discussions today have brought up some things you need to let go of, to be freed from, be forgiven. So today we're going to use the spiritual practice of mending. This practice of mending is based on the Ignatian spiritual exercises. It focuses on forgiveness, forgiving others, forgiving ourselves, and receiving forgiveness from God to live more freely. It is at the heart of Christianity and is something that humans need to do to live well and flourish. Forgiveness is a central theme of Christianity, rooted in the love of God who offers forgiveness. So if you'd like to make sure you're sitting in a comfortable position and ready, and start with the pebble on the floor or on the table next to you. I'd like you to pick your pebble up and think about something that has hurt you. Maybe a hurt or painful memory because of something said or done to you. It might be a small thing or a big thing. Might be a situation close to you or more distant. I'd like you to hold your pebble in your non-dominant hand, the hand that you don't write with. I want you to picture the time you were hurt by this situation or person. Allow yourself to feel the pain you still carry. It may feel a bit like being hit by a stone that's thrown at you. Observe what emotions are involved. Is it anger? Resentment, sadness. Notice what you feel in your body. Are you tense anywhere? Or do you feel heavy? Notice your thoughts. Are they spiteful, hateful, or something else? I'd like you to move the stone to your dominant hand. The stone could be used as a weapon. It was thrown at you, so you could throw it back. Would that make anything better? How might it make things worse? Resentment, bitterness, and hate of ourselves or of others all work away at our insides, robbing us of joy and stopping us from being the human beings that we are meant to be. We can't always see justice done, but we can be set free from the hurts. If any of you have read The Shack, there's an amazing quote in there that says, "Forgiveness is not about forgetting, Mac. It's about letting go of the other person's throat." Resentment, bitterness, and hate of ourselves or of others all work away at our insides, robbing us of joy, stopping us from being the human being we are meant to be. We can be set free from the hurts. Feel the burden of the hurt inside. Ask yourself, who is it that is suffering? Have I carried this burden long enough? What will I do with all my hurts? Will I carry them forever? Or will I choose to let them go? To choose to let go of hurt is to forgive. Am I willing to forgive? the answer is no, that's okay. Because some wounds take more time and need more time than others to heal. And if you're ready to let the burden go now, use your breath to help you do so. Breathing in, acknowledge the pain. Breathing out, and think about releasing this burden from your heart and from your mind. You'd like to put the pebble back on the floor or on the table next to you, or hold onto it and place it by a cross later on. Know that as you forgive, you also are forgiven. In the Lord's Prayer, we find the instruction or invitation, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. We rest in the space where we are forgiven. Christ has set us free. This means we are really free. Father, help me to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help me to give myself away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. Spirit, help me to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all I do and say. Amen.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Okay. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us today. Our 45 minutes are up, so I'm going to call an official end, if you would like to go at this point. God bless you. The church is open from next week for public worship. So Sunday, the 2nd of May, we're going to have a Holy Communion service at church. There are still some tickets available, I believe, if you would like to join us. And then communion will happen every week on Wednesdays as well. So our first one on the 5th. If you have a couple more minutes, there is a song of blessing that Linda has found that we'd like to play for you all, which will be a really suitable way, I think, to kind of bring to a close this season that we've had online all together, with an awareness that it will be carrying on for some time for some of us. But it feels like a definite end of something. And it's good, I think, to be able to mark that with some words of blessing. So we're going to listen to those now. And then after that, we'll stay on for half an hour or so we can all catch up.
Just to say, it's a familiar blessing that many of you remember from last year. But I think what is really has really hit me with this, watching this recently, is sort of it's a blessing that's been done by the children. And there's something very, very powerful about the next generation blessing us. And although the words are familiar, it's just something really special that children can pray over us as we go from this stage to the next stage and the exciting things that God has for us in store. So I'll just share.